Hello, my name is Ea Suzanne Akasha, and welcome to this podcast where I'm going to interview Louise Steen Kryger, who is the Rapid Response MHPSS Delegate coordinating the international response from the Federation for COVID-19. Louise is a psychologist by profession, and she began her career with the movement as a volunteer in 2004. She has extensive international experience within the field of MHPSS, both from headquarters, and she's also been in the field. So I'm going to ask Louise, there was a resolution on MHPSS recently and a movement policy. Why, how do they come into play when it comes to caring for staff and volunteers?
Yeah, very, very interestingly, and the policy was adopted just recently last year, and it applies to all three components of the movement, both the national societies, the IFRC and ICRC, in all mental health and psychosocial support activities. And this policy recognizes the variety of complementary activities carried out by the different movement components in all contexts, and it includes an increased focus on the mental health and psychosocial well-being of the volunteers and staff, as the volunteers and staff well-being is often also affected in the course of the work. And this calls for the whole movement to address the mental health and psychosocial needs of volunteers and staff. So this is really important. And in the policy, policy statement number 7 is for protection of mental health and psychosocial well-being of staff and volunteers, and it has a number of guiding points that we can work with within the movement.
But why is the well-being of staff and volunteers, why is that of importance for any national society?
I think the protection of the mental health and psychosocial well-being of staff and volunteers is vital when we look at the provision of sustainable quality humanitarian services. If our staff and volunteers are not taken care of, and if they're not able to take care of their own mental health and psychosocial well-being, how are we to take care of others? Like it's said in the plains, we need to put on our own oxygen masks first before assisting others, and this is also highlighted in the caring for staff and volunteer toolkit provided or produced by the PS Centre.
Mm-hmm. But some national society, I've heard that said again and again, worry that it's too expensive and too costly to establish such support systems, and also they need to invest staff time. So how do you argue with them? What do you say?
Yeah, I would say it's more costly not to do anything. If we're not supporting those who are in the front line and those who are doing the actual job, it may lead to increased stress responses, and this could have a longer term negative impact on the psychosocial well-being and the mental health of staff and volunteers, and be more costly for the national societies, as they would have to support staff who might be on sick leave for a prolonged period of time, or having to recruit new staff, new volunteers, train, build the capacity. So from a HR perspective, I would say, well, it's definitely more costly not to do anything. Poor performance could jeopardize our reputation, and we might also risk that staff and volunteers become disillusioned and are lacking motivation. Secondly, I don't think we need to debate this really. It is the responsibility to care for those who are at risk. That's the mandate of the Red Cross, Red Crescent movement. And staff and volunteers who are responding to emergencies such as COVID-19, they might put themselves at risk. They might also be affected the same way as the population we are trying to support. And as a volunteer-driven organization, I think the Red Cross and Red Crescent movement needs to lead by example. And it's so important that we take care of our own and support our own supporting others.
What would be the positive outcomes for staff and volunteers if these support systems are established and they work well?
Reduction of stress, I would say, definitely would be one of the key outcomes, would also be, well, healthy and happy, maybe dedicated and motivated staff and volunteers. I believe we see less fatigue in staff and volunteers. We know that the volunteers and staff in an organization like the Red Cross, Red Crescent, is they're very often driven by idealistic and ideas and motivation to do something good for others, and have maybe a tendency to forget themselves. So having someone else taking care of them by setting up structures that supports the well-being, I think it's a very caring environment to work in, and it fosters good spirit and higher work ethics, basically.
Higher work ethics, that sounds good. And what could be some of the examples of activities that could support staff and volunteers during COVID-19, where a lot of the support has to be done remotely?
Some distant support, like having phone calls, regular phone calls from someone in your organization, or having a hotline that you as a volunteer can call, either anonymously or if you want to make yourself known, that's possible as well. This should of course be cost free, so we need to ensure that volunteers have the means to use these opportunities for calls, either calling or receiving calls. It could also be free calls to a psychologist. Again, both ways, having the opportunity to call a psychologist without anyone in your organization knowing, and you don't have to report, and that the psychologist won't report back to the organization, so you have someone to confine in if you need to discuss certain experiences during work of duty or duty of care. It could be that you set up game nights, movie nights, have social dinners or cooking nights. And I know that this might sound a bit bizarre in a situation where we are maybe physically distancing ourselves from others, but some of our volunteers are living at the branches because they are not in a position where they, if they are to do the work that they're doing, they're not in a position to go back to their families, as they are afraid of risking their health or putting their families and loved one in dangers due to the work that they're doing. So having some social activities for them could also be an opportunity. Appreciation ceremonies and online gatherings, learning webinars or trainings online, anything that kind of stimulates new knowledge or new learning. It's also possible to actually do physical activities or movement online, such as gymnastics or stretches, dance parties, yoga, something that could facilitate also social connections, but focusing on something else than cognitive development. And then it could be a possibility to set up a buddy system. And if you're interested in that, then I recommend to listen to the podcast where you were talking to Despina.
That's right. And when you talked about all these activities that you could do online, dance, yoga, stretching, having occasions, celebrations together, it really brought a smile to my face. That was so interesting to notice. I think these are great ideas. Do you have more ideas for managers to what they can do? Do they schedule weekly meetings? What should they do? What else should they do?
I definitely think that it's worth having, looking at what trainings are required for the volunteers to volunteers or staff to engage in the activities they're expected to engage in. Are they properly prepared? That's the manager's responsibility. having these regular check-in. It's very individual what people need, but sometimes people do not know what they need, or sometimes people might not be able to express what they need. So setting up some regular activities as a standard procedure is very helpful. It's also very helpful to receive information about normal stress reaction, stress management, and positive way of coping. Have access to the right protective equipment and means to carry out your work, but also means to connect with others, whether that's by phone or access online. Managers are also, I would say, responsible for making sure that the volunteers and staff have proper job descriptions or terms of reference for their assignment, and that it fits with what they have been recruited to do, and that their job is coming with a time. Like, we're not working 24/7. There could be systems in place making sure that a shift maybe is 8 hours, and making sure that the volunteers and staff also get some rest. And I think this is something we need to, this whole thing on caring for staff and volunteers is something we need to have as a default budget line in all our project budgets.
So what a great lot of ideas that you have come up with. So let me ask you, as the rapid response, the global rapid response MHPSS delegate, how do you think that the movement, if you see it from the helicopter perspective, how are we doing it at for the time being in caring for staff and volunteers?
It's interesting. We've seen a shift, I think, over the past few years, where in the beginning, caring for staff and volunteers was something that was only applied in psychosocial programs. Mm-hmm. And we're now seeing that it goes across the different sectors. I've been very happy to see how many national societies have actually already included budget lines and activities for staff and volunteers, and not only for the psychosocial staff and volunteers, but also for first line responders in general. So I think we are getting there, and I think with back to the policy and resolution, with that in mind, I think we are also heading in the right direction.
Thank you very much for taking the time out of your busy schedule.
You're more than welcome. Thank you.
Thank you.